job. You don't even know if it's good yet. Thank you very much for breaking the weather this evening. Usually I like to start right away and just play because it makes it a little bit more exciting. But this first tune is super cool and I want you to join us along. It's kind of something that we do. This tune, Pennsylvania 65,000, it kind of has an interesting story. It's by the Glenn Miller Band, a very well-known jazz group. What's important for them is that they really changed the history of how we hear big band music. Glenn Miller was really well-known for his military career. He really developed that jazz. The jazz ensemble within the Air Force. What's interesting about this piece is the popularity, but it's really based on what's considered the oldest phone number in America. It's a long number and it ends with 65000. And so up until COVID, you could still call that hotel in New York and it would play part of, for the ringtone part of the song. What's interesting also is there's a little bit of a talk section where the band screams Pennsylvania 65000. So of course, we're going to do this with us. Okay, where's our triangle? So for this, they're all important, but this is the most important person on stage. When you hear this sound, you say Pennsylvania 65000, okay? We'll do it first to show you what we're talking about. 65,000. That is 65,000. See, but what did I do with that? Here you go. Why don't we take it from that A section of the melody? Don't play the melody, just before we get to that. So the A section. From A.
Pennsylvania 65,000.
interesting, I should say. That trumpet solo you heard, awesome, so great. Joel, it's going to have what's really neat about what the students are working on is they're playing professional music, like professional performers would do. I myself have played this song thousands of times, and I grew up performing this song in college, and grew up performing this song professionally. And that trumpet solo he read is the actual trumpet solo from the recording, recorded many, many years ago, and is considered today one of the most important trumpet solos in history, a big band, and he's doing a great job of performing it. So great job, man. All right, so this next piece we're going to continue our show with is Summertime. Anybody heard of this tune before? Summertime? Okay. So a very well-known opera called Porgy and Bess by George Gershwin. George Gershwin is extremely important in our history in America. One of the biggest reasons, maybe, because he skirted the line of different genres. So he wrote a lot of classical works for bands and orchestras and operas, and then he also wrote a lot of jazz works, a lot of Broadway music and show tunes. And that's very unique, because what we'll see is this collection of American music, when you think about the Great American Songbook, it's really the music that's originated in America, but it has a lot of different influences. Very often we study music from everywhere else, and we don't think about the wonderful music that's been created here as part of our history, artistically, in a lot of different mediums. And the nice thing about this tune is most of you have probably heard this, either on record, in a movie, if you've actually seen Porgy and Bess before, but it's nice that this music still lives on. And that's what really makes it this kind of song that we realize and study in school and eventually play for audiences every day. So this is Summertime from Porgy and Bess. Let's say, for example, if you recorded a song where you record compositions, the radio plays, but you're not getting paid for that performance. Today we have rules for that, we have laws for that, but during that time we didn't. So the musicians need it, but you had to be a part of it to perform in New York and in the big cities. Said, well, we'll go on a strike. No record for 2 to 3 years. Very interesting, though, is the fact that vocalists and guitarists were not considered official musicians at that time. What that meant for 2 or 3 years, for almost a generation of individuals growing up during that time, in their teenage years in high school, all they heard were singers and guitar players. And follow our history, that's why today we have singers and guitar players being the stars of popular music, because that kind of continued the record industry. Now, something interesting and positive did happen. Not that we don't like singers and guitar players, but new music started to emerge because all of a sudden, artists at that time weren't interested in pleasing the crowd or selling records. Instead, they were thinking about innovation. And what happened in the American side of things in New York was a nice little invention called bebop. So if we study the classical literature, we find that there are periods. We have the Renaissance period, the Middle Ages. Eventually, we get to a very interesting period called the Baroque period. A lot of you may know it because of Bach and beautiful melodies, a lot of ornamentation. Well, popular music in America, in this case jazz, went through the same evolution, and we got bebop. During this time, there were a lot more melodies, and the melodies were more ornamented, everything was faster. It was more about the technical proficiency, similar to an aria from the Baroque period. It's more about the technical proficiency and ornamentation that you're doing in the music. And this is where we get Charlie Parker, nicknamed Bird. And the reason they call him Bird is because he was considered to play so fast and clean on the saxophone, he was like a flying bird. And so Yardbird Suite is a tune that was written for him to perform. And Miles Davis is on this record, if you've ever heard that name before, one of our most influential trumpet players in history, who is interesting because he's been a part of every genre of music in history, in the top of the world records, from rock, classical, to everything to think about. He's been playing with symphony orchestras. But Charlie Parker became the example of what this music was about and ended up influencing what we all do as improvisation artists. And later on, what modern classical composers do and the way they had extended chromatic harmony in their music since about 1960s and 70s. So this piece specifically is really neat because it features our alto on our trumpet, two of our sophomores, Corey Upson and Brooke Degenhart, who are playing the part of Charlie Parker, Bird, and Miles in the back. And they'll play a little bit of this, and you'll hear from Brooke for the wonderful solo. So here's Yardbird Suite. One more, actually. It will also feature Juan Salinas, who has the biggest heart you can imagine. And they laugh because they know this guy's in the practice room every day. It will also feature Juan Salinas. Thank you. get more and more interesting. Watermelon. Anybody heard this before? How many of you are, I can't see too well. Anybody here in band somewhere? Been in band? Jazz ensemble? Okay. Have you played Watermelon then? Yeah? See, the reason I say that is because it's one of those tunes that in our American literature is extremely important and relevant because we study in school, we perform professionally, and a lot of what we're doing. And it has a history musically of what's happened. Herbie Hancock, which recently passed away, unfortunately, is one of those people on piano that has been part of our music in America for a long time. Not just in the jazz world, but in the funk world. And the funk, if you know about jazz and blues and funk, you know everything you listen to, even from Lady Gaga to who knows what young people listen to today, is influenced by that music because of the harmonic structure that's on there and the rhythm. And all of that really comes from albums like these where they're experimenting with pushing harmony, what we're listening to and what we're comfortable listening to also pushing the rhythm, making more exciting what's happening. And so in this piece, this record in particular, every single song in the record, the Herbie Hancock's Headhunters, is kind of known for being its own rich, historic American artistic expression of what's happening in the 70s and 80s, and what's leading into the music that we listen to today. What's really fascinating is that Herbie Hancock, and you can search him online for yourself on YouTube videos, he has a ton of tutorials on the piano, but he was very heavily involved on the classical side of things, conducting orchestras, performing concertos with orchestras, and you often realize that these musicians, the reason they're so important in history isn't because they play a pop song or a jazz song or they know how to solo, but because they're overall good musicians, and they're involved in a lot of different genres and a lot of different experiences. So in this case, we get the kind of fun funk side of things. So feel free to clap along, enjoy a little Watermelon, and here's Watermelon Man, and we'll feature our bad dude tenor saxophone player, Juan Salinas. And I should say this, it will also feature our incredibly well-lit drummer, Cooper. All right. You know, that's the best part of my job is it doesn't feel like a job. It's so much fun. All right, so as we continue with the show, we heard a little bit from our Barton Jazz Ensemble. And what's interesting about this ensemble is it involves a lot of different people. What you'll see is these same students are playing in a lot of different groups. And that's the neat thing, not just instrumental groups either. We're talking about vocal groups as well. Sorry about working on some of the theater. We recently had our Mamma Mia production, and many of these students were involved with that process. And so the neat thing about this is it gives us a lot of talent and resources to do a lot of different things. And so about a year or so ago, I realized we were missing a very important group, kind of a commercial ensemble group. And we call it the Rock Band, it's called the Riff. But really, it's a group that encompasses an overall idea of, to some degree, what the students like to listen to, what the audience enjoys listening to, but also a great way to educate these students that what they're listening to, they can perform, and to understand what's happening within the music, beyond just listening to the music for fun. So what we do for this group is, we tend to pick a song that one of our vocalists can sing or is interested in singing. We analyze the song, we figure it out on our own, and then we write an arrangement for ourselves on the song that fits what's happening. So in this case, you'll hear from Braden. And Braden came up to him one day and said, hey, because he talks like this, hey, I really want to do a singing in the rain. He's a big guy. And I'm like, okay, whatever you want. And then so he showed it to me, and I was familiar with the song because, again, it's an incredibly well-known song, a jazz standard, but also well-known for it's a romantic comedy about Hollywood in the 1920s, which is what a wonderful era to experience. There you see, big guy. He was like, hey, Dr. Foster, I really want to do this.
I've never heard
that one. Doesn't matter. And I said, sure, this will be a lot of fun. And so slowly this group came together and we started adding individuals, and we said, okay, well, we can make this more like a jazz combo, more authentic to the style that's really being performed. And then I had a wonderful guest with us here today, and he said, hey, you know, man, I can play on this too. And I said, yeah. And the reason I do that is because that's what happens in real life. When you're performing with professionals, especially on the jazz side of things, there's not a lot of rehearsal. These are well-versed musicians who know the literature, know the vocabulary, know how to perform, and have performed this many times, they can just come in and do it. And a lot of times, it's what we're doing. So we're going to hear a little bit from him, we'll hear a little bit from Brooke, but most importantly, we'll hear from Hayden. Most importantly, we'll hear from Braden and his wonderful interpretation of this very well-known Broadway piece, Singing in the Rain. And they convinced me to play piano on this. I really didn't want to. I kind of barely got one. Can we turn that down just a little bit? I should say this. In the back, we have a wonderful group of sound engineers, light engineers. We have Leon, Soma, and Jacob. This, I'm going to say pronounce your last name. Without them, this wouldn't be possible. Can we please give them a hand? And while we're talking about the technical side of things, I'd also like to have a shout out to our dean, Brian Howe, who helped us set up the cameras and record for us this evening.
Clouds so dark up above.
All right. I really enjoy here. It's really nice. Okay, so the night's going on. There's a lot of stuff happening. And as we get set up for our next section, I'd like to talk a little bit about some of the opportunities you have, if you're interested, your children have, and really community members in general. As a standard of practice, we're really open to the community performing this. So there are some community members on stage that I'll highlight shortly. But beyond that, if you have any children, if you have any siblings, cousins, friends who are interested in taking lessons, we do offer scholarship even if you are not a student at Barton. If you are 16 and over, or have a gifted IEP and are younger, we have a program available for students to take lessons with us. I do all the instrumental lessons, minus our percussion, that's some of our percussion instructor, Grant Matthews. Ms. Jessica Perez does all the vocal lessons. But the neat thing about that is, these students in high school and middle school can study with professionals that have been doing this for a long time, and get that college instruction early on. For parents, the better is that it's free for you, and it can count towards college credit. In the future, doesn't matter what major you're studying in. So that's kind of important to keep an eye on. The other thing is, as far as the groups that we have available to us, on the instrumental side of things, we have our concert band, which you're about to hear. You heard a little bit from our jazz ensemble, from our riff, rock, commercial group that kind of plays it all. We also have a pep band. It's really popular in basketball games, and we do other events around town and on campus. On the vocal side of things, we have our concert choir. We have our Hilltop Performers, which is a dance show choir. And then we also have our acapella groups, our treble and bass acapella groups, the capo and the dolce. So there's something for you to do. It doesn't matter what you want to do. Reach out to either myself or Dr. Foley, our choral director, and we'll get you in contact if you need to, or we'll get you in the ensemble performing list. And the reason I say that, The reason I say that is because within this ensemble, we have a lot of those individuals present. So I'd like to highlight some of these. If you are a high school student taking lessons through that program, please stand up. All right, so these two, this is Dawson and Riley, and they're both taking lessons with me. And the neat thing is we work on everything from college auditions to their festival solos. We just had a wonderful regional festival here for some of them. And they get that opportunity to work with me, but also play in the group, okay? Have a seat. You're a community member who is not a student at Barton and has come to perform with us tonight. Please stand up for us. All right, so Alan, don't hide back there. The one trying to hide on the timpani, see, you made a mistake, Alan. You just reminded me of something. Alan, sitting in the back playing timpanis, has been part of Barton, I think, more than anyone, really. How many years have you been performing with us? At Barton, both as a student? Doesn't want to admit it, but he was made here way back when, obviously before my time here, before our previous director's time, way back to J. E. Webster, is what you told me the other day. Yeah. And so it's really nice that we have that avenue here, and then we also have a little bit of the future generation. So here we're featuring today, Hannah, you heard honking on the Barry saxophone. But we also have another special guest, Maddie in the back. Raise your hand, Maddie. So Maddie joined us yesterday. So this is a lot of pressure for her, but we really want to give both of them a hand. They're in middle school, 7th grade and 8th grade, right? 7th and 8th grade. And what's really neat about them is that they're here and they're the future of Barton. And that's really what we're fostering, not only the future, just, you know, getting a chance to perform, but to get the experience of Barton early on and get them on track to realize what they want to do with it. It doesn't have to be music by any means, though that's exactly what I want both of them. But even if it's not, it's okay. They get to experience a college life and get a little bit better prepared when they get to that stage in their life. Which, Maddie, were you the one that wanted to be a band director? Were you the one that wanted to be a band director? No? Okay. Not yet. Soon. I also want to talk about our two members that came to join us today, our wonderful trombonist and our wonderful saxophone player. Guys, I met in Wichita, and this is part of it too, and the wonderful thing about having faculty that are involved professionally. You make these kind of connections through performances, through meeting others, and they can come give us as guests of their talent. So just one round of applause for them driving out of the room. Lastly, in the back, the guy with the most serious face but the most beautiful smile I've ever seen. Grant Matthews. He's our adjunct instructor for percussion, so if you want drum lessons, he'll be the one to take lessons from. Here is a little bit of the concert band. I've probably talked enough. Let me get my music, and we'll get started. There's something about these pianos. They always seem to want to be on stage. Before. Culture in this country. He is one of not the most important band literature person when it comes to marches. Everyone and anyone will tell you, even our previous band directors or anyone around will tell you the importance of John Philip Sousa, because he basically was the first superstar group in the history of the 19th century, or the 20th century. Before we had pop groups touring, before we had anybody touring, we had the John Philip Sousa Marine Marching Band touring. And he's a composer of a lot of our famous marches from Stars and Stripes. Oh, nice job, thank you. Stars and Stripes Forever, including the Semper Fidelis, the actual march of the Marine Corps. So he's considered one of the most important people in our history when it comes to band music. More interesting than that, or just as interesting, is that this arrangement was written by Frederick Fresnel. Frederick Fresnel is the elite pedagogue and music educator of our nation, and really of the world. What he did is he got all the music from the concert band literature and said, hey, this music isn't written in the best way for music education. Let's change it something. And what he ended up doing was writing the music and rearranging these pieces to fit bands that were beginning to emerge in the 1920s and 1930s as music education bands that you all joined in high school and middle school. So it's kind of an interesting thing that these students are playing that music. I do want to give a quick shout out to one more very important individual. I was waiting for this one because I wanted him to get through that piece first. And that is Mr. Mark DeWall. He's been the teacher of, how many of you studied with Mark DeWall at some point? Okay. And he's been in a lot of different places. We met at Central Plains. He was there kind of coming back from retirement because nobody really retires in Kansas. He came back from retirement to help out the group, and we met and had a great relationship. And it's wonderful to have him on stage performing with us with his grandkids. Where are you guys at? Hey, thank you for coming. All right, so we're moving on to Irving Berlin. Anybody heard of that name before?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, from what?
From high school.
From high school?
I was in a choral concert.
Oh, okay, very interesting. The reason you probably heard his name is because he's everywhere. He permeates all the music we have, and not just in America, around the world. What you may not know is that he's a Jewish immigrant. And he arrived to this country and worked really hard and moved up the steps. And you'll find a lot of these, like I mentioned about Gershwin. There were immigrants that came to America in the 20s and 10s and 30s and made a career in music on all spectrums, Broadway, emerging TV, in classical literature and orchestras, and obviously in jazz and show tunes. But I have this quote up here because it's beautiful. It's the first line of the song. God bless America, land that I love, stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. That's just beautiful. And that's really what this piece is about. And beyond this, if we're talking about Irving Berlin, he is a writer of most and many of Christmas music you've probably heard. Maybe you heard White Christmas? But you didn't know Jewish American wrote that. And to this day, fun fact, it's the number one recorded single in history to this very day. And the reason that's important is because we're starting to see this connection from this music, from the jazz scene, to the classical scene, to the show tune scene, we've already seen a little bit of TV, and now we're going to see how this plays out in an orchestra by the same guy that you hear writing White Christmas. Here is a little bit of, let's use the word, of God Bless America. See, the reason I like this is because I really like that point. I was like, I can't wait. It's got to happen. Here we go.
Thank you.
Extend my gratitude to these wonderful people on stage who have done so much. Many of them are... Okay, why not? Let's just clap. They really are incredible students, incredible community members, and I think the really nice thing about this is that love for music ties us all together. Some of them are vocalists, and they're playing in band because they want to get a little bit extra scholarships. Some of them are professionals coming in to play with a friend. Some of them are just band directors that are here having some fun and playing on the side. But the important thing is we're bringing in a lot of people here, and I think that's a really unique thing. A unique thing about Barton, we're really trying to include the community in everything that we do. So, with that in mind, we'd like to finish out the show with a little bit of Rap City Blue. Anybody ever heard this before?
Yep.
No? Okay, a couple of you. Again, by George Gershwin. And I really wanted to end the program with this piece because it demonstrates almost a culmination of everything that happened in America from late 1800s until really now. Like I said before, George Gershwin is very important because he's well known for what he writes and what he composed across the board, jazz ensembles to full orchestras. And this is one of those pieces that what he did is he brought in a lot of the classical music and then combined that with some jazz harmonies and jazz rhythms. And as part of this opera that he created and he developed, he brought in this kind of main staple, and it's become the staple for clarinet playing. There's actually a clarinet concerto, which what that means is a clarinet featured with an orchestra. We have a really neat arrangement that features the entire orchestra. And I won't lie, this took some preparation to get together. This is why I'm extending my gratitude, because these students have really worked hard with me. In many rehearsals, I'm like, nope, again, nope, again, nope, again. We're finally to the point where we have to say, not again, just enjoy the performance. So here is Rhapsody in Blue. Thank you so much for coming out this evening. Hope you enjoy. I have to make sure to put it here because Leon gave me a speech about making sure the mic was back.
Thank you.
Well, this is more than that.